Hi everybody, welcome back to my channel. And if you're new to my channel, hello, my name is Gabby and welcome. Welcome to my true crime corner of the internet. If you've never been here before, I cover true crime cases and all the cases that I cover. A little bit more on the vintage side, they're all basically 20 years or older. So if that's something you might be interested in, maybe go down below and click that subscribe button. We would love to have you here. So this is the first video in a new series that I am starting on my channel. It is a series that I've kind of wanted to get the ball rolling on for a while on my channel, and I just haven't. And it is called Let's Gab. My name is Gabby. I like to talk. You get it. Basically, in this series, I'm going to be going over a case that I just recently covered, and I'm going to be going through the comments on that video. And if the comments are discussion worthy and there's a lot of good questions and there's some things that I can add to the case, I will do a Let's Gab video about the case. But before I get into this first video of this new series, I have to say that today's video is thankfully sponsored, and it is sponsored by Skillshare. If you've never heard of Skillshare, Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands upon thousands of classes that overall allow your creativity to blossom. It's a place where you can interact with fellow creatives, where you can enhance current skills and also develop new ones. You can dive into a class for literally anything from animation, illustration, music, photography. You can build your business with such classes as business analytics and marketing. And of course, there's also some self-help classes, which are my personal favorites. Whether you're trying to manage stress, overcome boredom, find a new hobby, or help your business, Skillshare is for you. The class that I recently took is called Revolutionary Self-Care: Embrace, Nurture, and Grow Your Authentic Self, and it is taught by Chidera. She has this over-the-top personality that is just honestly addicting to watch. Her class is basically mostly dedicated to helping people express themselves in their most authentic way while unlearning all that self-doubt that we've been taught our entire lives and learning how to finally invest in the main person you have, which is you. It is sponsorships from companies like Skillshare that keep my channel going and also help me be able to put more money to the side to donate to fundraisers like the fundraiser that is currently going on for the case that I'm going to be talking about in today's video. If you want to check out Skillshare yourself, the first 1,000 people that click the link in the description of today's video will get a free trial of Skillshare premium membership. All of that being said, let's get I was gonna say get Gabbin, but that is like way too corny. So let's just get right into the video. So if you did not watch my last case video, pause this video, go watch it, come back, because if you did not watch that video, the video about Beth Doe, her identification, the arrest made, all of that, you're not going to know what is going on in today's video. So pause it, go watch it, come back. As most of you know already, after 44 years, Beth Doe was finally identified as Evelyn Cologne. There was a bit of mispronunciation in my video on my part. I do apologize. It was basically because when I first dove into this case after she was identified, I was watching a bunch of news clippings, and that's how they pronounced her name. And when I spoke to her nephew, I didn't even think to ask. I originally thought it was pronounced Cologne, and then hearing it pronounced a different way, I didn't even think I should have asked. That was my mess up. I do apologize for that. There were quite a few comments on that video that really got me thinking. They were things that I didn't necessarily think of myself as I was researching, and I'm not even sure if the family thought of themselves. So I really just wanted to do this chit chat video. I'm just going to jump right into some of the comments. One thought that a lot of people had, and this comment here basically sums up that thought. This person says, "Who was Lewis's accomplice in the dismemberment and body disposal? No way did Lewis chuck out the suitcases of a moving vehicle without someone else driving the car." Somebody did comment under that comment, and they said it's possible that he pulled over and tossed them. And that's honestly what I was thinking when I originally researched this case. But according to pretty much all of the reports, police do believe that these suitcases, all three of them, were tossed out of a moving vehicle. So we kind of have to go off of what police think happened. Doesn't mean that's necessarily exactly what happened, but we kind of gotta go off of what they were thinking. But that does leave us with the question, if they were thrown out of a moving vehicle, who was driving? Because there was no way that somebody was driving and also that same person was able to throw three suitcases basically at the same time out of this moving vehicle. Somebody else had to have in some way helped him. Now, I have not seen anything online when it comes to this. I have not seen any police statements referring to somebody else being involved and wanting to know who that person or who those people were. You do have to remember though that a case is being built right now and a lot of information they are not going to release to the public. We don't know exactly what crucial information police know when it comes to this case. But we do know that police are asking anyone with any more information to please come forward. They have released a statement saying, "We strongly encourage anyone who feels they can provide insight into this case to contact state police. The number to call is 1-800-4-PA-TIPS, which is 1-800-472-8477. And callers should reference media release 1956. So if you are out there and you have any information at all to add to the case of Evelyn Cologne, you are urged to call that number. There was also a very interesting comment about one tiny bit of information in the case, and that was the ink that was written on her left palm. Somebody commented and said, WSR followed by a couple hard to decipher numbers scribbled on the left palm sure sounded like a partial license plate to me. I'm pretty sure that that comment was the only comment on that video that said anything along those lines. And I think that is a very plausible theory. It's a very good idea. I think that if there's any way for authorities to check license plate numbers from 1976, I think that's something that they should definitely do. The only thing is that they were able to tell the letters, but they were not able to tell the numbers. Also, her writing that on her palm, we don't know if that even has anything to do with the case at all. There was also a comment that somebody had, and they said, "I wonder if the boyfriend did it, that he did it out of anger due to a girl being born, not a boy." Well, the thing is that due to the condition that her body was in, we know that she definitely did not give birth. She was still pregnant with the baby when she was murdered. So the baby was definitely not born by that time. And if you mean that possibly they did an ultrasound and found out that the baby was going to be a girl and not a boy and he was angry because of that, keep in mind that this was 1976 and we did not have that technology at the time to find out the sex of a baby. Also in my video, I did go briefly into the state of her teeth. She did have quite a lot of decay, which would have caused her a lot of pain in her life, but I did cover the fact that she had a fractured tooth. One person commented and said, "Her fractured tooth spoke volumes. One more woman pregnant, abused, frightened, and alone with a gruesome end. She most probably was trying to leave, and her boyfriend asserted his power over her." We do know that based on what Evelyn told her family members before she was murdered, that she was in an abusive relationship with Lewis. So her having a fractured tooth very well could have been because of the abuse and not necessarily the state that her teeth were in. But when it comes to the decay of her teeth, it very well could have been because she was pregnant. A lot of people are losing their vitamins, they are not obtaining enough calcium when they are pregnant, and their teeth can start decaying. As we know, Evelyn did not go out much, and because she did not go out much, I'm sure she didn't go to a doctor regularly. It was kind of like she was in this abusive relationship and she was in the house almost at all times. Another comment that a lot of people had was about the fact that Lewis Sierra was 19 at the time that this happened. And I did not say this in my original video, but I did find out after that Lewis Sierra was 19 and he was also a junior in high school. I do understand why this was a common comment on my video. I do completely understand it. But do at least remember that authorities did determine that whoever dismembered her remains was most definitely not skilled in the fields of medicine or anatomy. And also keep in mind that as time goes on, more and more information about this case will come out. So we don't know what they're currently finding out right now and what they will find out in the future. The last comment that I do want to highlight in this video says, I have a few questions about the letter. If it was after the murder and the baby was removed separately, wouldn't the murderer have known it was a girl and not a boy? As I type this, I realize it could be just more lies for the fantasy of the life that he imagined and his imagining for what the family wants to hear in his own twisted way. This was definitely a thought that I had myself while I was researching. If he had dismembered his girlfriend and taken out the baby from her womb and discovered that it was a girl, why would he have written in the letter that it was a boy? He did tell authorities that if he had a child, he would have wanted to name it Louis Sierra Jr. So it very well could have been some sort of twisted fantasy that he wrote in this letter to the family, thinking that none of this would finally be pieced together and that they would ever find her remains. Overall, a case is being built. All of this information, as of right now, by law, is alleged. We cannot say for certain that he did it or not. We are just looking at the information behind everything and kind of forming our own opinion until something is eventually set in stone. But when it comes to a reasoning behind things, you have to think that if there is an individual who is evil enough to take the life of somebody, but especially somebody that they are supposed to love and also their unborn child, not everything is going to make sense. You have to think that somebody who is capable of doing something so evil, somebody who is genuinely just a monster, their brain does not work the same way that a normal person's does. And when I say the phrase normal, you know, like, what is normal? But I'm really meaning people that are not capable of doing what he allegedly did. Before I end this video, I do want to say a huge, and I mean huge, thank you to my amazing subscribers who have donated and also shared the fundraiser that Evelyn's family have put together to try to give Evelyn and her baby girl a proper burial. Every single time I tell you all about a fundraiser, you all seriously come through. The fundraiser goal is $15,000 and it is currently at $8,790, which is just amazing. And if you cannot donate to this fundraiser, at least just share it somewhere, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, somewhere. Just, this family definitely deserves it. And Evelyn and her daughter deserve a proper burial after all this time. If anybody else wants to donate to the fundraiser or of course share it in any way, I will have it down below in the description of this video. Thank you for taking a little bit of time out of your day to hear me gab about a case that definitely means a lot to me and now apparently means a lot to some of you all. And I will see you all in the next one. Bye.